in Mark chapter 14 to begin. And we're going to talk about the battle that won the war. Many, many times we forget that wars are won or lost before they ever begin. Many, many times, especially spiritual wars, especially and even physical wars. I mean, how much preparation goes into the strategy, the planning, such as that. And so we see Jesus in this, and Easter's coming up, and in the next weeks, I hope and I pray to remind you that the cross was the greatest battle ever fought. It literally was the war. If it weren't for the decision of that war being in the favor of Jesus Christ, we all would be in a terrible place today. It would not be good. We would be lost in our sin. The Apostle Paul spends a whole chapter, 1 Corinthians 15, talking about the resurrection of Christ. And if it weren't for that, everything we do would be in vain. We would still be in our sin. So this morning I want to start, and we're going to begin to look at this prayer of Christ, this prayer time. Three times he asked his disciples to pray with him, and all three times they fell asleep. And I believe the churches are sleeping today. Not a lot has changed. It's still asleep. And so this is to awaken us. This is to enlighten us. This is to cause us to begin to pray as we've never prayed before. And so let's just jump in. Mark chapter 14, verse 32. And they came to a place which was named Gethsemane. That's important. There the name is, in the sense that it has a lot of meaning. We'll talk about it. And Jesus, he said to his disciples, "Sit here while I shall pray." And he took with him Peter, James, and John, the inner three, the inner circle, and began to be sore amazed and to be very heavy. That's Jesus. And saith unto them, "My soul is exceeding sorrowful unto death. Tarry ye here and watch." And he went forward a little and fell on the ground and prayed that if it were possible, the hour might pass from him. And he said, "Abba, Father, all things are possible unto you. Take away this cup from me. Nevertheless, not what I will, but what thou will." And he cometh and findeth them sleeping, and saith unto Peter, "Simon, sleepest thou? Could not thou watch 1 hour? Watch ye and pray, lest you enter into temptation. The spirit truly is ready, but the flesh is weak." I can't even walk without him holding my hand. And again he went away and prayed, and spake the same words. And when he returned, he found them asleep again, for their eyes were heavy, neither wist they what to answer him. They didn't know how to answer the third time. And he cometh the third time and saith unto them, "Sleep on now, take your rest, it is enough. The hour is come. Behold, the Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners. Rise up, let us go. Lo, he that betrayeth me is at hand." Well, I want to tell you, Jesus was a soldier. If there ever was a general, that's a general. Our heavenly commander, the Lord Jesus Christ. Many wars had battles that were very decisive that changed the course of history. But the most important battle of all time, as we've just seen, was not a military or a battle of nations at all, but it was a spiritual battle. And it was fought and won at Calvary, but literally the battle began in Gethsemane. And so Gethsemane's got a very interesting name. The Bible tells us that we're in a battle as well. The battle we're in is against the spiritual forces of hell, the spiritual forces of evil. I was just talking to Jason a while ago, and we were talking about the difference from when we were young kids versus today. Humanity's always had depravity to deal with. Ever since the fall in the garden, the human nature is depraved. It's fallen. But yet we can see a difference from when we were kids to today. It was easier to find 10 people who genuinely cared about people when we were young. And today, if you can find one, it's pretty awesome. Amen. The majority of this culture seems to be selfish, focused on themselves, and it's apparent in the evil that is reigning and ruling so much around us. Jesus, as our heavenly commander, is fighting a battle for us. He's giving us an example. And so this morning, I want to walk through the garden with him. I try to do this myself before Easter, but I want to take this church through the Garden of Gethsemane. Now, you need to remember, this was the night in which Jesus was betrayed. This is the night when the upper room discourse, as we read about, was happening. Judas was betraying him. Jesus is prophesying about Peter, who would deny him. The Lord's Supper's being instituted. We still observe the Lord's Supper today because of what Jesus did this night. There was a lot on the plate of the Lord Jesus Christ. Sometimes we get into these situations because we're stressed, because we have a lot going on. And yes, we do need to know our limitations. But I want to tell you, when you take the hand of Jesus and let him lead you, you can do all things through Christ who strengtheneth you. And the same is true with me. And perhaps our problem is, it's not that we're doing too much. Our problem is we're not holding on to the hand of our Savior. Many, many times we're going where he would never take us. We assume that this is the place of our service, when in fact, God has a purpose for everyone in this room this morning. God wants to plug you in to the ministry of his Son, Jesus Christ. And until the church is all plugged in into their places, we will never be the church which God has purposed for us. We need the people of God. And so we see this battlefield, and one of the first things that just fascinates me about the Lord is how much he accomplished under the stress and duress that he was under. You say, well, he was God. Yes, he was. He was 100% God, but he was also 100% human. And so he was just like us in that regard. And yet, he fought the battle, and he succeeded, and he accomplished all that God had purposed for him to accomplish. Now, in the Garden of Gethsemane, we're going to see the devil attack. And believe you me, there's not a person in this room that's been attacked by the devil like Jesus was. Many times, we deal with a demon. I don't know that anyone in this room has really dealt with Satan himself. Satan's got an army. But Jesus dealt with the devil himself, full force, and perhaps all of the demons of hell that could be thrown. And here he is, suffering, and here he is dealing personally with all that hell can throw at him. And he succeeds. First, let's notice about this word Gethsemane. What does it mean? It's the field where the battle was fought. Look at verse 32. Gives us an interesting account. It says they came to a place which was called Gethsemane. That's not just thrown in there. I believe everything about the Bible has a purpose. God has a purpose in telling us. He could have just said they came to a field, they came to a place. But no, he mentions the place. He mentions the name. It was a favorite place of Jesus to pray. And I've never been blessed to go there, but those who have told me in their writings, as I've read them, that the olive trees are impressive in Gethsemane. They're old. They're very, very old. And they're twisted and they're gnarly. He said, it's almost as if you can see the curse that God has put on the place because of what happened there. It looked like a battlefield. The olive trees were used in Jesus' day. Olives were used as a medicinal factor. Remember the Good Samaritan? He came along and the guy was beaten, and what did he do? He poured oil on his wounds. It was olive oil. Olive oil is derived from pressing and squeezing the olives, crushing them first, almost like grapes. And so Gethsemane means crushed. Gethsemane means the crushing. And so here is the Lord Jesus Christ, and he's in the place of prayer, and he's going into the place to meet the Heavenly Father, his Father, our Father, and he needs the Father's comfort. He needs the Father's direction. He needs to hear from his daddy. I want to tell you, Jesus needed God. Boy, how could we ever think we can do it on our own? Mark's gospel gives us this account of that historic night. And just before this, the Bible says they ended their time in the upper room and the Passover feast by singing psalms. It was a time of singing and a time of rejoicing. But the mood quickly changed when Jesus called out Judas, his betrayer, dipped the bread, put it in his mouth, and then also Jesus told Peter that before the rooster crowed, he would deny him. And yet Jesus even knew that all the disciples would flee. And so he calls them to pray. In Mark 14, verse 18, and as they sat and did eat, Jesus said, verily I say unto you, one of you which eat with me shall betray me. That's Judas. And when they had sung a hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives. There it is. And Jesus saith unto them, all you shall be offended because of me this night. It is written, I will smite the shepherd and the sheep shall be scattered. Jesus wasn't making prophecy on his own. He was quoting the word of God. Jesus knew that he was the shepherd. And Jesus also knew what the word of God said, that because of sin, the shepherd would be smitten. And the sheep are going to scatter. Jesus understood there was a battle to be fought, and on earth he would be fighting this battle alone. Praise God that wherever we go, Jesus refuses to leave us. We have a Savior who knows what it is to go alone. We have a Savior who went alone for us so that we would not have to. And yet we have a Savior who shows us that God will never leave you alone. The walk from the upper room to the Garden of Gethsemane, it says after they sang a song, they went to this place in a field which was called Gethsemane, verse 32. And so the walk there was very short, I'm told. But I'm told it's very steep. To leave from the Mount of Olives down to Gethsemane is a descending walk. A descending trail. And as Jesus descended into the depths of despair and depravity, his disciples are following him. They crossed a brook called the Kidron Brook or the Kidron Valley. And I'm told that this brook water flowed from the Temple Mount. And many, many times this brook flowed red because of the sacrifices that were made in the temple. Blood literally filled the creek. And perhaps because it's Passover time, can I get a witness? All the sacrificing, all the festivities, all that went on in the Jew,
Perhaps the creek was flowing blood red. All of this shows us about what's fixing to happen. And Jesus understood it. Jesus knew the Word of God. Jesus knew exactly why he was here. It was a narrow stream, and as his disciples crossed this bloody creek, they walked a few more hundred feet to an olive grove called Gethsemane that spread across the lower flank of the Mount of Olives. Can you see the picture? The Mount and Gethsemane. Gethsemane means oil press. And so it's no accident that God tells us about this place and that Jesus chose this place to pray. It is on this night that Jesus fought, perhaps. You say, preacher, the battle on the cross must have been quite a battle. Yes, it was. But I want to tell you, I believe that battle was won because of what he did in Gethsemane. This is where he made his decision. I will do it. So that's the field where the battle was fought, but now I want you to see the suffering. Boy, sometimes we forget, as we deal with suffering, Jesus said, if they persecuted me, they will persecute you. I see persecution on the rise, and it's fearful. But yet, dear friend, I want to tell you, we need to set our face. As Jesus set his face toward the cross, we need to set our face toward preaching and teaching the gospel. And so, Jesus is going to this place to pray, and he says to his disciples, sit here while I shall pray. He took with him Peter, James, and John. So the majority of the disciples are set at one place, and he takes the three with him, and they go a little further. And I suppose it's why we have this account. They could hear what he was saying and praying. Amen? And so they went a little further with him, and so he sets them down, and they see something that touches their heart, but evidently not enough to stay awake, but they were surely touched that Jesus became sore amazed. Now, I don't know the King James English. I'm not an expert at it, but they also say very heavy. Jesus was moved in suffering, and Jesus was hurting in a way that touched their life enough that they wrote about it. They saw Jesus in a way they had never seen him before. And he turns around and says to them, my soul is exceeding sorrowful unto death. Tarry ye here. Stay here and watch. Now, he's not talking about watching him. The watch was a watch of prayer. Jesus was asking for prayer. Can you get your mind around that? Our Lord is asking for people to pray for him. Man. And they slept. He went forward a little and fell on the ground and prayed that if it were possible, they heard this, that this hour might pass from him. Luke tells us in Luke 22, verse 44, and being in agony, he prayed more earnestly. Then his sweat, Luke said, became like great drops of blood falling down to the ground. The medical term, I'm told, is hematidrosis. It literally just means the capillary in the pores of his skin. Because of so much stress, the small capillaries burst and blood began to ooze out of his sweat, with his sweat. And so here's the Lord Jesus under such extreme stress and shock that he's literally falling to the ground, and he's asking his disciples to pray. Now, why does God tell us this? I don't think it's to show us that the disciples were worse than we are. It's to show us how much we need the Savior ourselves. It's to show us human nature. To show us what would happen apart from the Lord Jesus Christ. There's only one reasonable explanation for the Bible to use all of the expressions that I've talked about. Jesus was not afraid to die. I don't believe that. What Jesus had never experienced was the enormous guilt and load of sin that he was taking upon himself. This is God in the flesh. Sin has nowhere to be in the presence of God, and yet here is the Lord Jesus, fully God, fully human, and now he's taking our sin upon himself. And so God's showing us the cost of sin. We're talking about the suffering that he supplied. I want to tell you, as we go to the cross, I'm moved every time when I read the statement, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? As Jesus, the Lord of glory, hanging on the cross, for the first time in his earthly experience, realizes what it's like for God to turn his back. Who could not look upon our sin. Dear friend, I want to tell you, there's many people who think they're going to get to heaven on their own merit. I want to tell you something. You are lost in your sin. And until you receive the Lord Jesus Christ as the only atonement acceptable to God for our sin, until you receive his blood, you will remain forever lost. And Christ died for our sins, according to the scripture. The Bible says he was wounded. Isaiah prophesies he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement for our peace was upon him. And by his stripes, we are healed. Jesus experienced physical pain. Jesus experienced spiritual pain. Jesus experienced emotional pain. All of the above. And yet, here we are today crying the blues. I want to tell you, the closer to the cross Jesus got, the lonelier he became. Someone once said, it's lonely at the top. Jesus lost all of his friends. But I want to tell you someone he didn't lose. He never lost God the Father until God had to turn his face while Jesus died for our sin, your sin, and my sin. That was the most horrifying experience, I believe, for the Lord Jesus. When his friends weren't sleeping or deserting him, they were denying and betraying him. We call it Good Friday, and it is good. We only know it's good on this side of the cross. Good grief, who would ever call that day good back in Jesus' day? But we know it is good because of what Jesus accomplished on the cross. He was rejected by the Romans. He was rejected by the Jews. He was rejected by his disciples. And yes, even at the moment he took our sin, he was rejected by God. He was smitten for our transgressions, bruised for our iniquities. So I want you to see the Savior. Not only we've seen the field, we've seen the place of where God had accomplished all this, but now I want to focus on the Savior, and I'll close this. And I'm going to wrap it up with a little prayer, but in verse 36, he says, this is Jesus' prayer. They've already seen him fall on the ground. He cries, Abba, Father, all things are possible unto thee. Take away this cup from me. I want to stop right there for a moment. When you are suffering and you feel weak, understand this, that there were moments when Jesus felt weak too. For him to pray, I pray this hour would pass. I pray this cup would be taken from me. That was in weakness Jesus was praying. I wish this didn't have to happen. But nevertheless, I want you to focus. Not my will, but your will be done. And he cometh and he finds his disciples sleeping. And in verse 38, he had told them, again, watch and pray, lest you enter into temptation. The spirit truly is ready, but the flesh is weak. And again he went away and prayed and spake the same words. And when he returned, he found them sleeping again. I would have lost my temper. Anybody in the room about right now? Amen. We would have all lost our temper. Not the Lord Jesus. I want to tell you, when you come to Jesus Christ, you're coming to the most understanding, gentle master and savior you could ever imagine. He is a man of sorrows, acquainted with grief. He's the Lord of lords and the King of all kings. And yet he is never too large that he cannot understand our every need. And he cares. Just as the olives were crushed three times to get all the oil possible, Jesus was crushed three times by his own friends. You know, it's hard walking with the Lord and trying to do God's will for your life when the world is going south. I want to tell you, I've preached in both worlds, if you think about it. When I started preaching, we could truly say United States of America was a Christian nation. But it's been under my watch as a pastor that the nation has rejected God. I've watched it. And I want to tell you, it was much easier preaching when good people came to church. Does that make sense? I mean, there's no one good. We know that, but you know what I'm talking about. It was easy preaching when the majority of people still love the Lord Jesus Christ. And it's much harder today. But excuse me, if the Lord could speak, he would tell us how much more it was in his time. He lost everybody, even his own disciples. He asked for prayer and they neglected it. And then Luke tells us again that there was an angel that showed up that strengthened him. And I'm so glad God called Luke to write a gospel, because otherwise we wouldn't know this. Jesus is praying and the disciples are sleeping and everyone's deserted him. But God sent an angel to him. And he ministered to him. Luke writes, Jesus' prayer was, Father, if thou be willing, remove this cup from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but thine be done. We've seen that in Mark, but there's verse 43. And there appeared an angel unto him from heaven, strengthening him. You know, I don't know what the angel said. I wish it did. Maybe the angel showed Jesus again what was beyond the cross. The glories of heaven. Maybe the angel gave him some word, something that just reminded him of all the promises of God and strengthened. I don't know. But Gethsemane was where the world's greatest battle was ever fought. And so if you think about it, the real battle for Calvary was not exactly hanging on the cross. The real battle was already fought in Gethsemane when Jesus accepted all that must be done to accomplish what needed to be accomplished. I thank God he won the battle. I stand here today, and Easter is a time of victory and a time of celebration and a time of praise, because Jesus won the battle. And one day he's coming again. And so our mission is to do what he has told us to do between now and then. So I want to close going to the book of Acts just very, very quickly, I want you to show, I want to show you something. I don't think the sound room has this, but Acts 4:29, I want you to see something about the church. Now, this is the early church. This is right after the church was born. These are the disciples doing the ministry. Now, let me set this up by asking a question. What were the disciples like when Jesus needed them at the cross? They were fleeing. But when we see them just a few weeks later, they're bold. What happened? They saw the risen Lord. They saw him die. They saw him buried. And they saw him alive. And that changes everything. Now, in Acts 4:29, we're going to see the church praying. Now, this is right after the gate Beautiful. I don't have time to go into that, but the lame man healed at the gate called Beautiful. Now, I want to tell you, Peter and John, number one, they're men of prayer because it's the time of prayer. And that's why they're going to the temple to pray. And it's at the time of prayer that they run across this guy who's crippled, and he's begging and he's pleading, and Peter looks at him and says, "Silver and gold have I none." That's been the story of my life. "But what I do have, I give to you. In the name of Jesus Christ, get up and walk." And he not only got up and walked, but he was leaping. That's revival. They tell me in church history, I can't remember who it was, but he once said, the Pope or something was bragging about all the gold they had in the Vatican and how they would never have to say again, "Silver and gold have I none," because we're rich. And some wise guy like you was there and heard that. "We'll never have to say, 'Silver and gold have I none.'" And then the wise guy said, "Yeah, and you'll never be able to say, 'In Jesus' name, get up and walk,' either." That miracle happened at the gate Beautiful. And Peter and John were taken out and beaten because of that. Now, this is how I want to close. We need some holy boldness in the church of Jesus Christ. I want you to notice that prayer. That church prayed that they would be bold, that they would continue to be bold. And then in verse 31, I think it is, God answers their prayer. So, what do we need today as we stand in this place, as we see the Lord Jesus fighting his battle? This is what I ask of you. Pray for me that I would always stay bold. I would boldly preach the word of God. Let us love boldly. Amen? Jesus tells us not to return persecution for persecution. He says, when you're persecuted, love your enemies. Boy, that takes a work of God. But that's bold. Let us not only preach boldly, witness boldly, pray boldly, love boldly, but let's just boldly stand for the truth of God's word until he comes. God bless you. I know I'm late. God bless you. I can't help it. Let's all stand as musicians come forward. Maybe there's a decision you need to make for Jesus Christ. Today's the day. Maybe you're realizing, you know, this is a church which God has led me to. I need to plug in. Well, join. Come join our church. Become part of the family of God here at Cove. Let's put your spiritual gifts to work for the kingdom of God. God bless you. Maybe you're here, I need baptism. I've never been baptized. I don't know what decision you need. Whatever it is, will you make it today as we sing the song of invitation?
Just as I am without one plea, but that thy blood was shed for me, and that thou bidst me come to thee, O Lamb of God.
Some are continuing to pray. If the music would continue very softly, just pray right where you are. I'm so thankful that God hears our prayers. And that's only because Jesus paid it all. He opened the door. You know, the veil in the temple was torn in half. That was a veil that hung in the most holy of places where God's presence was. It kept man, sinful man, away from an awesomely holy God. The veil separated. But when Jesus died on the cross, the veil was torn, and it was torn from top to bottom. Man, it wasn't torn from the bottom to the top because we couldn't do it, but God can. And he did, all in the person of Jesus Christ. And we have this awesome privilege to pray. We have this awesome privilege to witness and to serve for the Lord Jesus. Whatever decision you need to make, won't you make it as we sing one more line?
Just as I am without one plea, but that thy blood was shed for me, and that thou bidst me come to thee, O Lamb of God, I come.
You continue. Come on. My prayer is that a revival would hit Cove, Arkansas. Mm-hmm. And I'm willing to give God all the credit. How about you?
That's right. That's right.
One of the things, as I've been reading through this holy boldness part, is the disciples, number one, the first thing that happened is people marveled that Peter raised that man up, said, in the name of Jesus, get up and walk. And they said, wow. And he said, why do you marvel at this? I'm not the one who did that. It was Jesus of Nazareth.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And so it gave him opportunity. And it's, listen, church, are you willing to give all the glory to God?
Yes.
For everything you do. Macklin says, amen. I love that. God bless you. Let's close in prayer. Brother Kelly, we're going to be praying for you. Tuesday, you pray for us right now, if you would.